Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Afghanistan, which moved one step closer to restoring peace as the intra-Afghan dialogue and the US-Taliban dialogue, both held in Doha, turned out to be fruitful. While the intra-Afghan dialogue was called unofficial by the Taliban, the insurgent group committed to oblige the decisions taken during the meet. A report.
Afghan representatives held a two-day talk with the Taliban in the Qatari capital Doha as the insurgent group intensified its attack back at home. Brokered by Qatar and Germany, the meeting was third of its type this year, with earlier two being hosted by Russia. Both the sides agreed to a roadmap for peace which could bring an end to the 18 years of conflict. The Afghan representatives said they were optimistic of reaching a permanent solution if sustained efforts were put in from both the sides.
Well, we believe so more than ever before. There is real promise, especially now that the Taliban and the Americans are approaching a deal. We believe we're very near. A lot of the differences have been resolved, so it's just a matter of time.
Numerous countries have backed the talks and have been instrumental in facilitating a conducive atmosphere for the same. Taliban agreeing to talk with the Afghan delegation, which also comprised people from the government, however not in the capacity of government, has been the major takeaway so far, as the insurgents have never considered Kabul a stakeholder. It has even accused Ghani government of being a stooge of West.
سيتم استئناف المفاوضات غدا ان شاء الله بين امريكا وطالبان وهذه مساله ايضا في غايه الاهميه لابد يتم التوافق على ما تبقى من نقاط خلافيه ونحن نعتقد بان الفجوه الان اصبحت ضيقه وصغيره بين امريكا وبين طالبان.
Taliban says these talks are unofficial, however, it takes them seriously and feels morally obliged to them. Taliban also says that it will also take steps towards ensuring that non-combatants are not affected and killed in the battle between two sides.
This is not official negotiation. These were informal talks. It has, on moral obligation of this, has the weight of moral obligation, and it was a collective demand of the participants of this 2 days conference, and they asked from all sides that also for reduction in the civilian casualties, and demand for withdrawal of all foreign forces from Afghanistan, because they confirmed the statement of the Moscow conference.
Earlier, the American negotiators and the insurgents completed the seventh round of talks, which ended with hopes of reaching an agreement that would see US troops pull out in return for a commitment that Afghanistan would not be used as a base for terrorism. Taliban and US officials are trying to strike a deal on a Taliban demand for the withdrawal of US and other foreign forces, and a US demand that the Taliban not let Afghanistan be used as a base for terrorism.
Pakistan's duplicity regarding the illegally occupied regions of PoK and Gilgit Baltistan is exposed. The story of its constant atrocities on the people of occupied territories is known to all now. Recently, a number of activists held demonstrations in front of the United Nations in the Swiss city of Geneva to gather more international attention and support. A report.
Political activists from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, who are living in Europe and UK, organized a protest against Pakistan's occupation and subjugation during the 41st session of UN Human Rights Council session in Geneva. They chanted anti-Pakistan slogans and sought freedom from the oppressive clutches of Pakistan. From exploitation of resources to the rapidly expanding terror camps, the activists highlighted a large number of plights being endured by the people of PoK and Gilgit Baltistan in their daily lives. Activists also underscored the poor state of judiciary, which has become highly biased in its judgment, owing to a rise in the interference of security agencies in their affairs.
हमने ये demonstrations इसलिए किया है कि पाकिस्तान की wrongdoings, जो human rights की gross root violations हो रही है, लोगों को शेड्यूल फोर्स में डाल के उनकी वॉइसेस को सप्रेस किया जा रहा है गिलगित बल्तिस्तान और पीओके के अंदर और स्पेशली चाइना और पाकिस्तान की कोलैबोरेशन से जो लोकल लोगों की जो मसाइल और मसाइब में बहुत ज़्यादा इजाफा हो गया है तो आज की डेमोस्ट्रेशन में हमने बेसिकली इन टेररिस्ट इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की डिसमेंटल की डिमांड की है और तमाम जो पोलिटिकल प्रिजनर्स हैं उनके रहा करने की बात की है और जो सब लोगों को फ्री एंड फेयर ट्रायल होना चाहिए और इंटेलिजेंस एजेंसीज की जो जुडिशरी मैटर्स के अंदर इंटरफेरेंस है उसको ख़त्म करने का मतलब है।
It is an established fact that Pakistan breeds, supports and exports terror from its soil. It has not only provided safe havens to terrorists on illegally occupied Kashmir, but has used terror as an instrument of state policy to spread mayhem across its borders in India and Afghanistan. Activists from different countries appealed to all to join their hands in fighting against the menace of terrorism, which is being exported all across the globe by Pakistan from illegally occupied regions of Kashmir.
The problem being that Pakistan is using it as a breeding ground for terrorists that they export worldwide. So it's everybody's problem. It's the international community's problem. The way the people in Kashmir have been treated by Pakistan is appalling. It's an international disgrace.
The United Kashmir People's National Party also organized a conference and highlighted Pakistani atrocities in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and Gilgit Baltistan. They strongly opposed the construction of hydropower projects on Neelam and Chelam River near Muzaffarabad city in PoK. The projects have severely affected the ecology in the region and the residents have been facing severe water crisis. The speakers also highlighted the growing issue of enforced disappearances and extrajudicial killings of political activists in the region. Islamabad is using the draconian Anti-Terrorism Act as an instrument to crush the voices of reason and dissent. The activists have regularly been carrying out protests and demonstrations in a bid to gather attention from the international community. However, they have received only little success as of now, as their plights and Pakistan's barbarity have just reached the debates and discussions and has not materialized into any concrete action.
Moving on, it is not just the Kashmiris, but the Balochs, Sindhis, Ahmadis and minorities too who are enduring the brute misrule of Pakistan. However, all have decided to resist this operation. While Sindhis held a demonstration in Canada, Balochs carried out a protest in Germany where they highlighted the atrocities being carried out by Islamabad. A report.
Members of Baloch Republican Party recently held a demonstration in Germany to highlight gross human rights violations in Balochistan. The demonstrators raised the issue of ongoing abductions and forced disappearances and extrajudicial killings by Pakistani security forces to muzzle dissenting voices in Balochistan. They urged the international community to pressurize Islamabad to release hundreds of Baloch missing persons reportedly lodged in torture cells. Baloch activists have long blamed that Pakistani media has completely blacked out the situation in Balochistan, a region under Pakistan's illegal occupation.
by the name of the projects of CPEX and other projects like Sendak and Rekodek, Pakistan has always looted Baloch resources along with China. When the activists, the social society's people, doctors, teachers, lawyers, anyone try to raise their voice and concerns about the Baloch genocide and Baloch resources, then they have been abducted or killed.
A number of Sindhis gathered in Canadian town of Mississauga to protest against the rising number of PAK atrocities against them. The Sindhis, who are predominantly Hindus, suffer widespread atrocities, some owing to the state prejudices against the religion, while others for politics. The Pakistani security forces have stepped up their violence since the inauguration of multi-billion China-Pakistan Economic Corridor project last year. State subjugation has also emboldened the Islamic fundamentalists, who anyway treat the minority as second-class citizens and address them in fiddles.
Moving on to Bangladesh, where the protracted plights of Rohingya refugees have grown rapidly owing to the heavy monsoon rains. Thousands have been displaced while thousands more are in queue. In spite of the efforts put in by several international organizations, the lives of Rohingya have not changed much since last rains, which claimed several lives. Earlier, in a visit made by former UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, had reassured the affected that his organization was tireless in its efforts to provide a better quality of life to these refugees. A report.
Thousands of the Rohingya refugees are working at securing the hills which surrounds their camps, using stabilizing terraces made of filled cement piping and sandbags to try and secure the slopes from further landslides. Despite tall claims made by different international agencies, the situation is rapidly becoming grim, as more than 22,000 people have already been affected in first 10 days of July, compared to 19,000 in whole of July last year. The World Food Programme, the food assistance branch of the United Nations, however, says that it is prepared for any condition and there will not be any shortage of food during the season.
There have been days of heavy rains in the Rohingya refugee camps here in Cox's Bazar, and the situation is serious. Thousands of people have been displaced and thousands more have damaged to their homes. But WFP is well prepared for incidents like this, and we prepare all year round for it. For example, we have emergency food supplies pre-positioned around the camps so that we can respond quickly when needed. And in this instance, we were able to get emergency food supplies to people within the space of 12 hours.
While everybody's life has been battered, it is the children who have suffered the major brunt. The efforts of education have met a major roadblock with these rains. A UNICEF report says that thousands of children are at risk of flooding as weather is likely to get harsher in coming times. So far, five UNICEF-supported children's learning centers have been heavily damaged and over 750 have been partially damaged, interrupting learning opportunity of over 60,000 children. At least 12 child protection centers have been damaged and one playground completely submerged by heavy rainfall. Earlier, in a visit made by the former Secretary General of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon, who is now chairman of the Global Commission on Adaptation, said that his organization was tirelessly working to provide refugees a life free of worries and anxiety.
They are taking on huge responsibilities in making sure that these helpless Rohingya living in very poor conditions, but they are now being able to live without much worry.
The reality, however, is that everybody has made promises, but life of Rohingya doesn't seem to get better. They have for months been demanding safe repatriation, but different bottlenecks have forced them to stay in conditions that are not humanitarian by any measure. Things have become even harder for the refugees ever since both the governments of Bangladesh and Myanmar have been trading blames over the present situation.
Moving on, while all eyes are focused at the peace process, Taliban and the United States, a rare story of hope and resistance is hard to miss. An Oxford postgraduate is taking books to the doorsteps of young Afghans who were just not ready to move out of their homes in a constantly declining security situation. In a country where there is just one library with limited books, this initiative of a mobile library by an individual, Freshta Karim, is truly proving to be a blessing for young minds. A report.
Charmag's Walnut in Dari is providing a safe place to the children of Afghanistan to read. The library on wheels offers pupils and street kids free access to children's books, which are in short supply at public schools and libraries. It also offers one of the few spaces outside the home that children can use in a city where fear is increasingly keeping residents behind closed doors. The buses, which are rented from the government, run 5 days a week, stop at various schools during term time and community areas during holidays, and have about 400 visitors a day. On board, there are hundreds of books in Dari, Pashto and English ready to be dived into.
تمام کتاب های قصه رو که خواندم ما به یک دنیای دیگه رفتم.
ما وقت کتاب مطالعه میکردیم بسیار خوش میشدیم چون کتاب بسیار چیزها به ما یاد میدهد و ذهن ما روشن میکنه.
The library bus was launched in February by Oxford University graduate Freshta Karim, who has dedicated herself to improving the reading and storytelling abilities of children in Afghanistan, an opportunity she never had as a child. Karim returned to Kabul in September 2017 after getting a master's degree in public policy from Oxford University, and 6 months later set up Charmags, the non-profit organization that runs the two mobile libraries as well as a mobile cinema. The vehicles are painted with colorful stars, balloons and footprints, and refurbished with shelving, desks and chairs, a luxury in a country where 4 in 10 schools do not even have a building, according to Human Rights Watch. The bus is one of the two mobile libraries that Afghanistan's younger generation not only bring an education, but also hold on to as much of their childhood as possible despite living through war.
Right now we have two mobile libraries and one mobile cinema, and it's providing services in different parts of Kabul, in West Kabul and in another area which is a little bit disadvantaged. We are committed to continue this work, but really gradually starting from Kabul and going to provinces.
Afghanistan now has one of the world's lowest literacy rates, with only 3 in 10 adults able to read, according to the United Nations Cultural Agency, UNESCO. According to the United Nations, 3,804 civilians, including more than 900 children, were killed and 7,000 wounded in 2018, the deadliest year for non-combatants in the conflict.
I think for education, peace is highly important. For our children to have a peace of mind, to go to school without a fear, without a fear of explosion, without a fear of a bomb blast.
Since 2001, the Taliban have been waging an insurgency to overthrow the Western-backed government. Though peace negotiations with them have gained momentum, fighting has intensified and civilians still bear the brunt of the long-standing conflict.
Moving on to India, where the famous Rath Yatra or Chariot festival is underway in different parts of the country. Dedicated to Lord Jagannath, his sister Subhadra and brother Balbhadra, the procession is one of the biggest and widely celebrated occasions of India. Though it is celebrated with same fanfare in different parts of the country, but the one held at Puri in Odisha is just beyond comparison. Take a look.
A sea of devotees thronged the beach town of Puri to celebrate Jagannath Rath Yatra, which is dedicated to Lord Jagannath, his sister goddess Subhadra, and his elder brother Lord Balbhadra. Popularly known as Gundicha Yatra or Chariot Festival, it is one of the most awaited festivals of Odisha as well as nationwide. The Rath Yatra begins with the idols of Lord Jagannath, along with the idols of his sister and brother, being taken out of their home at Jagannath Temple. Placed on huge decorative chariots, the three deities travel to Gundicha Temple, said to be the abode of Lord Jagannath's aunt, where they remain for the span of 9 days, and later they come back to the Jagannath Temple.
ये रथ यात्रा जगन्नाथ जी की रथ यात्रा है सारे साल में इस यात्रा में इसलिए निकलते हैं कि दुनिया को दर्शन दे सकें जो लोग मंदिर के अंदर नहीं जा सकते हैं भगवान इतने कृपालु हैं कि उन सबको दर्शन देने के लिए खुद सड़क पर आते हुए सबको दर्शन देते हैं ये अपने ये रथ से निकलकर ये अपने गुंडीचा मंदिर की तरफ जाते हैं और 9 दिन रहने के बाद में फिर वापस आते हैं
The city witnessed the huge rush with the bustling crowd dancing and singing on streets amid beats of cymbals, drums and gongs while pulling the chariots of deities using long ropes during the grand procession. It is believed that pulling this rope adds to good karma and those who do this get relieved from all types of sins and attain salvation. As the procession moves forward, A wave of spirituality and euphoria sweep the entire city. The devotees feel enlightened and their emotions run high at the moment they get the glimpses of Lord Jagannath.
केवल अगर कोई दर्शन भी ले ले जगन्नाथ जी का उसके सारे के सारे पाप नष्ट हो जाते हैं और आज के दिन खासकर यदि कोई जगन्नाथ जी के रथ के रस्से को खींच लेता है अथवा स्पर्श भी कर लेता है तो पद्म पुराण अन्य पुराण कहते हैं उसको वैकुंठ की प्राप्ति होती है उसको मोक्ष की प्राप्ति होती है
कंसीडरिंग द लार्ज नंबर ऑफ पीपल हु गैदर्ड टू पार्टिसिपेट इन द फेस्टिविटीज द फेस्टिवल ग्राउंड इज ब्रॉट अंडर हेवी सिक्योरिटी with the police officials keeping a tight vigil during the Rath Yatra. Such conglomeration of devotees from different religious and cultural backgrounds coming to participate in this journey of love and faith manifests the integrity, equality and unity of our nation.
Puri Rath Yatra is the oldest Rath Yatra that takes place in India or the world whose descriptions can also be found in our ancient texts. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.